Don't you feel that we are maybe not at a turning point, but at some interesting moment with respect to the therapeutic potentials of the cells? Because I think that the pipeline of indications that are under clinical trial is really growing right now.
Right, so the first clinical trial using pluripotent stem cells derivatives was in 2009 by the company Daheron in California for spinal cord injury. And so this was using human embryonic stem cells, obviously not human IPS. And since then, few clinical trials have been launched. More recently, I would say, I don't know the exact number. This is something I should check, by the way, before. We can go back to this. There are probably around 50 clinical trials ongoing right now using human embryonic stem cells or human IPS derivatives. And you can see this number growing exponentially. So things can go rapidly if the first data coming from the first clinical trial are going well, but it will slow down depending on this. So it's really too early to tell at this point.
Yeah, and by the way, I have this this thing in mind that the first clinical trials are gonna be decisive. And I think also the quality of the cells is something that we should keep an eye on, because bad first events can really alter the course of how things develop. And that's clearly one of the things I have in mind, and I know that's something you have at heart too.
Right. I think there are two things that are very important is the quality of the cells, like if they have any chromosomal abnormality or mutation. So this is one thing. The other thing is the purity of the cells, because most of the differentiation protocols we have in the lab are not giving you a pure population of cells at the end. So if we have surface marker that allow selection of these cells before transplantation, that's one thing, but it's not the case for all cell type. So purity is one thing, quality, especially genetic stability, is another.
Yeah.
I would say I can add a third one as well, is that we know that cells generated from human embryonic stem cells or human IPS are immature cells. So at this point, there aren't good protocol for maturation of the cells in vitro. So the cells that are transplanted are usually immature, and the maturation happen in vivo. But a lot of work is done currently to find ways to mature the cells in vitro.
Yeah. My feeling has always been that if you want to resume a proper behavior of the cells, it would be best to go into conditions that are more alike what is their natural environment. And so I tend to have a lot of hopes with 3D culture, and I'm probably not the only one in that case. But I think it goes beyond, because recently there's been a lot of work on circadian rhythm to help push the cells. There's lots of things that we try to recapitulate to go in more in vivo-like conditions for maturations, if you have something on your mind with that.
Yeah, no, so you're right. There was this publication recently from the Doug Melton's lab. Is this the one you are referring to?
Yeah. Yes.
So there are a lot of work done currently to find ways to mature the cells.
Yeah.
It's still ongoing. But this is a big area of research to be able to do that in vitro.
Yeah. So it's very linked to what we just discussed, but do you feel that there is something that we should do better to improve the outcomes of cell therapies?
Yes, so you mentioned that 3D culture versus 2D culture. This is, I think, a great point. Most of the early protocol for differentiation were 2D. The earliest were even like co-culture. So you had to culture your cells on top of another cell type, obviously not ideal for transplantation.
Yes.
And since then, more defined, chemically defined protocol have been published. So it's definitely better, but it's not really recapitulating what's happening in vivo. So when you do the differentiation in 3D, you have, and this has been shown beautifully for organoids, brain organoid, especially where the cells self-assemble and some of the architecture of the brain is recapitulated in this brain organoids. So I think this is a very, very interesting a new step. And this is, again, an area of research that has grown exponentially in the in the past 2-3 years. And I think it's going to be very, very exciting to see what's coming up from that.
Yeah, it's sure that there is like a lot of that's very I'm also So I'm also someone who dabbled into pluripotency from quite a while, and that's very interesting to see the dynamic of the field that has been from the get-go very dynamic, but right now this I think again maybe it's not a turning point because everyone would be wanting to see turning points everywhere, but there is definitely some realization in the field that we are getting close to that, and that actually questions that used to be completely outlandish as to how do we ramp up production or stuff like that now are much more hitting home.
Right. I mean, for transplantation, I don't know if the new system, the organoid system, will be very helpful at this point because you cannot really control what are the cells in this 3D structure. And for transplantation, you would rather have something that is well-defined, but it's really, really interesting to study connection between cells and to study the environment of the cells. So I see a lot of application for research in the first place. Obviously, there will be application for transplantation as well in the future, but being able to recapitulate a mini tissue and find out all the connections between cells and the microenvironment will be key for the field.
Yes, that makes me think of two different things. But one thing is our goal in TreeFrog is also to standardize and to help with the production. And my maybe wild guess, but is that maybe rather than true organoids, it's more interesting to work with smaller let's call them tissue units because you have a better control as to what they are made of, and you also have some benefits as to a more in vivo-like environment for the cells to go further into their maturation and function. So how do you think about that?
Right, so it depends on the goal you have, but I can see for the best example again is brain organoid. And for some of the disease, for people with epilepsy, being able to work with brain organoids is going to be key to really answer the question you have. Again, if you're interested in transplantation, you will need to think differently about your system and the setup you want to get.
Yeah, I wouldn't divide that much between modelization and transplantation, because again, my belief is that the best cell is a cell that behaves as if it was in the normal environment. And so I get that there is a desire for purity, for example, but a normal cell is not, I mean, unless you're thinking about cartilage or other very specific tissues, you're actually a collection of different cells. And to work as a tissue, you actually kind of need to recapitulate these multiple interactions. So even though it's probably a challenge in terms of regulation, I think there is value even in therapy, and not only in modelizing disease, to recapitulate niches, to recapitulate interactions between cells, so that the approach is the cells that you graft, for example, are more readily functional, have a phenotype that is more relevant. So I wouldn't put a divide between the two.
Right, so I can tell you a little bit about islet differentiation, because we've done some in the lab. So we do this in 3D, and the cells we obtain after a mass differentiation are not all beta cells, obviously.
Yeah.
We have a mixed population. We have alpha cells, beta cells. So we have cells that are in the islet usually, which are good, but we also have cells that are not in the islet usually. So when you get this mixed population, if you want to use them for transplantation, it is safer for us to select the beta cells and inject only the beta cells. But for research, it's super interesting to have all these different cells that are in the eyelids usually, and being able to study their interaction. So at this point, I think that's why I make the distinction. I understand
yes.
your fear. If we can make a full eyelid in 3D without any other cells that should not be in eyelid, that would be perfect.
Yeah.
For this type of cells, we're not there yet.
Yeah. We still have work to do, definitely.
Right.
Also in terms of, so it makes me think about safety. And so what do you think, where do you think the field is going in terms of safety? More rigorous production means to have more control over what types of cells, or more gene modifications to push cells when in a given direction, or to counter-select or help with suicide genes? Do you think it's more the modification route, like genetic modification route, or more the better craft, better control over the cells route?
Yeah, at this point, I'm going for the better craft, as you said,
yeah.
rather than gene editing routes. We know already that there is a risk of genetic instability in IPS by the way they are generated,
yeah.
but where they are expanded and doing differentiation. So manufacturing a safe cell is already extremely challenging. Now, if you add to this an extra step of gene editing, where the risk of getting additional genetic abnormality is getting higher. So we are exploring this now. A lot of labs are exploring this now, which is good. I don't think these cells are ready for transplantation yet. We are just figuring out if we can manufacture safe differentiated cells from IPS and ES now, and the next step will be gene editing. So it's there, right behind, but first step is really to be able to manufacture safe IPS derivatives or safe ES derivatives for transplantation.
Okay. And so in your expertise, this question of genomic stability, would you say that the technology of reprogramming has to mature, that there is a lot of things that boils down to how good we are at reprogramming, or is it more about how we cultivate them or even how we differentiate them? Do you think there is one part that is the bad pupil in the class, or we have to work on all of them? What's your take?
So everything can be optimized, and there is place for optimization on each step. I think we've gone a long way for the reprogramming when Shinya Yamanaka started to use retrovirus or lentivirus system. So this virus were integrated into the genome. This IPS line still express sometimes CEMIC, so an oncogen. Obviously, we don't want to work with cells that can be potentially tumorigenic. So more recently, a lot of new reprogramming method have been established that allow the derivation of IPS lines that are totally free of transgene, no CEMIC, nothing. So that's a big, big improvement. I would say there is still things that can be improving this in the way we derive IPS, mostly because the two common way to derive cGMP IPS line are the episomal vector and the standard virus. And the episomal vector, unfortunately, can be integrated. And the first clinical trial from Japan,
yes.
where if you look at the first publication, they derived 40 IPS line, and at the end find only two IPS line that were clean enough to go to the next step. And a lot of this IPS line had integration of the episomal vector into the genome. So that's one of the issues with this method. The second method I was referring to is standard virus method. So this is a RNA virus, doesn't go to a DNA phase, so it should not be integrated into the genome. But it is a virus, so it could eventually affect the expression of some genes in the cell, so not ideal as well.
Yeah.
The third method that people use for derivation of IPS is the mRNA transfection, but so far this has not been used for cGMP derived IPS line, as far as I know. And there are still some challenges for that. So this could be one area of research to improve the derivation of cGMP IPS line using a method that is not using any of the current system. I haven't seen a lot of publication recently on reprogramming method. The most recent, I think, is 2018, so 2 years ago, and that was using a CRISPR activator. The idea is super cool. I love it. So what you do is you put the Cas9 activator and you push the expression of OCT4, SOX2, KLA4, and CEMIC in the cells. But again, in this case, they use an episomal vector or plasmid system, so it was not quite ready for cGMP IPS derivation, and it was not efficient. So there is definitely space here for improvement on the reprogramming part. The second part you mentioned is culturing cells, expansion of the cells. Again, here, we started, when I started as a postdoc, we used to grow the cells on meth. I'm sure you did this too.
Yes.
Right? And now we have chemically defined medium and much, much better system to grow the cells. So we are in much better position in 2020 than 2001. There are still area of improvement here as well. And one of the things is these cells, I think that where we could get something better is the splitting. So when you split the cells, this is when usually the stress comes up, and this is where a lot of cells start getting some genetic abnormalities. So finding a better way to split these cells would be very beneficial for the field. Number of cells, so for transplantation, we're gonna need billions of cells. So finding ways to culture the cells large scale, thinking still about this issue with splitting and how to make these cells grow and still be undifferentiated.
Yes.
With getting this number. So a lot of improvement here is necessary as well. So as you can see, there's quite a bit of things to do, but we are in a pretty good position right now to start the first clinical trial.
I think that that's a very interesting time because there are still lots of things to optimize, to discover, to do in the field, and yet we are not so far from bringing benefits to the patients. So that's really an exciting time.
Right, and the other thing is we have to learn how to manufacture cells. So all these big biopharmaceutical companies are used to make drugs, and they are good at this. But here it's a new product, totally different new product. It's a cell, and it's very difficult to, you know, do the quality control on a cell compared to chemical compounds.
Yes.
So we have to reinvent a totally new ways of dealing with drug delivery here, because the drug is a cell.
Yeah.
So it's gonna take a while, but I think it's really, really, really exciting because we are very close to getting the right cells now. Like we said, it is important to check if they are safe, and we have ways to check this, mostly using animal models. So you can make a big batch of cells and use this batch to test in animal models and to see if they form any tumor. And then if after 6 months, 9 months, they don't, you know that this batch of cells is good to go for patients. So you can see that the timeline is going to be much longer.
Yes.
And the cost is going to be much higher. But that's the new way of thinking now. What we're going to deliver is cells, not the drug, not the chemical compound.
Yeah. I think, the quality attributes, the quality control of cells is very complex, to say the least. And I just think the work that has been recently published from Japanese that were working with Parkinson's. So I think it's the work that is known in Sumitomo Dai Nippon. And the thing is, there were a lot of efforts on the Japanese side to do the right thing and to check the quality at a very strong desire to take the least risks before we go to the patient. And so they kind of demonstrated that even grafting pluripotent stem cells in NOG mice, so that are very prone to accumulate mutations, was maybe not that risky. I mean, I would have expected it to be more risky, actually. And mm-hmm. And even though I think there was a huge number of mice, like 80 mice with the graft, 80 mice, 50 mice without the graft, something like that. And actually, even when with some of the mice being grafted with purely pluripotent stem cells, there was no death nor metastasis in the NOG mice. So at least, I mean, not that we want to graft pluripotent stem cells, but I think it's a good sign.
Right. So I mean, for the first clinical trial, it is so important to focus on safety, and if it goes well, we can move forward to efficacy, like any different phase one to phase two clinical trial. Yeah. But because this is the first ever for this type of cells,
yeah,
obviously we have to be a lot more careful.
But I would argue, so I totally agree with you, and I think we must move very cautiously. But I think when we find a way to avoid the cell themselves to be a risk for the patient in terms of genomic integrity, but not only, but when we have cells that are more relevant, more akin to the phenotype that they're supposed to have, then we have some sort of the biggest experiment possible, which is the cells in the body are not toxic when they are not going bad in terms of genomic integrity. So as opposed to what you have with drugs, where you have interactions that you cannot anticipate because it's a new entity in a very complex body. Here you have cells that are not a new entity, hopefully, if we do the right job. And if we put them in the right place, then the risks are not the same. It's more a question of doing it right rather than understanding what may happen.
Yeah. So this could bring to the next thing is immune rejection, though.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a very important point, because we've discussed a lot about the concept of quality control that would take time. So it's not a problem in an allogeneic strategy, but if you want an allogeneic strategy to be successful, you have to handle the immune rejection, and that's a big topic. And what do you think about where the field is going now with respect to that?
Yeah, that's the thing. So I think it's interesting because if you think about human embryonic stem cells and human IPS, the only advantage I can see in using human IPS is the fact that you can do autologous. You can take blood cells or fibroblast cells from a patient, make these IPS, differentiate them, and put them back in the same patient. That's the beauty of it. But the cost is going to be insane. So there is no way we can do this in large scale. So then between the two, I would rather start with human embryonic stem cells and find some HLA match, a collection of human embryonic stem cells that can cover at least a large part of the population as far as HLA matching. And the reason why I would rather work or start with human embryonic stem cells is that the chance of genetic instability in these cells is much lower. The way they are generated compared to IPS, much lower. So between human ES and IPS, human IPS, I think human ES are much safer as a source of cells for transplantation than human IPS. But like I said, the advantage of human IPS is you could do autologous and then there won't be any immune rejection, or at least in theory.
Yeah.
So the field is going, the first clinical trial from Japan was done with an autologous system. So the cells were taken from a patient with macular degeneration. They made the IPS, they differentiate them into retinal pigment epithelial cells. and transplanted back into the patient. They did two patients, I believe, transplanted two patients, and then they switched to an allogeneic system because, again, cost, there's so many things that the timeline, it takes such a long time to go from taking the fibroblast or the blood from the patient to manufacture cells to transplant in the patient. So it is not viable in large scale. And so then they switched to this idea of making a bank of IPS line that would cover most of the Japanese population, and now they can make IPO, in this case, RPE, retinal pigmental epithelial cells from IPS, and have these cells ready to go whenever they want. So this is where the field is going. The third approach is genetically modified IPS line. As I said, I would not go for this at this point because I think we need to learn a lot more about safety of these cells before we can use them for transplantation. But this is definitely an area that people are exploring right now. And the idea is to make this
stealth. There is a lot of, in the vocabulary, there is a lot of stealth line. Universal cell lines.
The universal donor IPS line, so they can knock out some of the genes that will trigger the immune response when you transplant the cells, and then these cells will be like the universal donor. You need to modify quite a bit of genes, and I really think it's going to be very difficult to get cells that are safe for transplantation. But again, everything is possible a few years from now.
Yeah. Yeah, I think there is really a question of time, because I think in the short run, the approach, I like the approach of either ES haplobanks, like matched to be compatible with a lot of people, or IPS, because it's easier to source them. Obviously, there is not the issue of having access to an embryo, because hopefully there is not so much embryo that are not used for in vitro fertilization. But this approach, I think, is interesting because it's reminiscent of blood types. I'm O negative, so I'm a universal donor for blood. And I think, this approach, at least for a time, I think is an interesting approach, because you still have the benefits of the allogeneic strategy. You can look at your cells thoroughly, make long-standing tests to be sure that things are right. And even in the case of a patient, if the bank is already done, the differentiation is already done, then you can have a response time from issue to treatment that can be very short. So I think it's a very interesting strategy, and I agree with you that we need more work on the universal line, mostly because if it's really stealth towards the immune system, then if there are issues, if there is genomic instability or other issues, then the body would be weaponless to respond to this issue.
Right. So it is. It would be extremely dangerous to do that. So I think it's too early for that, but it's really interesting to explore it at this point. It's just like early stage again.
Yeah, but then again, early stage means we need to work on it right now if we wanted to.
Right. A lot of people are doing this.
Yeah. Exactly. Again, in terms of reprogrammation, there is, and also culture, I think more in general, the idea of reproducing more the environment of the cells, I think I used to be part of some sort of a fringe part back in the day of trying to make stuff more 3D with the perfusion, like recapitulating more the physics around the cells. But I think there is also a lot of metabolomics issues that we can deal with better accuracy. For example, the oxygen tension. For now, the cells are mostly cultivated with air oxygen tension, so meaning about 8 times what you would have in the body if you are about 5% saturation of oxygen in the blood. And even in the case of pluripotency, you should be more around 2% of oxygen saturation. So do you feel this is something that has to be done? I mean, not that it's something that is not known. It's starting to be well known. But do you feel it's something that needs to be implemented in research and in therapy?
I don't know. So all our cell culture are done on non-moxic conditions, so about 20% oxygen. We've done some reprogramming at 5%. And it was shown that this increased the reprogramming efficiency. So the only thing we were trying to get here is higher efficiency. We were not trying to recapitulate the environment. I haven't seen a lot of publication where people are doing this for differentiation, but I haven't really checked this very carefully. So I'm not sure. I know a few co-facilities that have all their facility at 5% oxygen. One of the issue here is your cells are going back and forth between incubator and biosafety cabinet. So the oxygen level go back and forth, high, down, up, down, up, down, which might not be a good thing. So
yes,
ideally you want a system that is totally enclosed. It is too expensive. So we haven't invested in this at this point. And I haven't checked, I haven't seen in the literature strong evidence that we need to go this way, or we need to put so much money to invest in this system.
Yeah, that's definitely a complex task to implement that, for sure. Yeah. So is mutational load of cells an issue in your work, in your daily work?
So I am a core facility. We are producing cells for customers. We do the reprogramming and we do gene editing. So obviously when we give the cells to our customers, we want to make sure they are fine. So we use the standard G-banding karyotype for most of our cell line. So it's very basic. We won't detect any small or large gain or deletion or gain. So it is very basic, but it's still the standard in most of the bank. This is the only thing they will show you to show that, to prove that the cells are normal.
Yes.
So we do karyotyping for most of the line that we use, but recently we decided to add one more test, which is the ddPCR for the gene BCL2L1. And we decided to do that for our gene editing service. As you know, along the process of the gene editing, we have to put a lot of stress on the cells. We nucleofect the cells. Then we do single cell cloning. So a lot of stress. And early on, when we started karyotyping all our clones that were modified, we got a lot of chromosome 20, the ISO 20Q.
Yeah.
So it was a lot of work. We had the right correction in the cells, and then we sent them for karyotype. It was bad karyotype. So the cost for us was huge. And yes, you know, we go to our customers and say, sorry, we have the cells, but they are bad. So we decided to implement this additional test. So ddPCR for BCL2L1, which is the gene on the chromosome 20 that is duplicated, and it's anti-apoptotic, so it gives some survival advantage. And since we switched to this, or since we added this step, we are much better at getting clones that are the right correction and the right genetic or that are normal, let's say.
Yes.
And we do it before stepping. We do it after the constriction. So we have different concentration of RNP and SSODN when it's knocking. And we also have different voltage for the transfection for the nucleofection. So we have different pools. We test the we do the ddPCR test on each one of these pools, and we choose only the pool that gives us a good efficiency, but also a very low additional copy of BCL12. And this helped us a lot in the workflow for the gene editing service.
That's very interesting, because actually, like ddPCR, there is a lot of technological goodies that you are implementing. So I think you're in a position where it's very interesting as a core facility, because you have a field that is moving forward very fast in terms of available technologies, in terms of needs from your customers. So I think you're kind of a testing grounds for stuff that will then become a very important quality attributes down the line for therapy and also for modelization. So you are the core of what we should be doing in the next year.
Well, so when I say the karyotype or gene karyotyping is still like the standard, it is kind of strange because we have so much better system than just a karyotype. And now some core facility use SNP arrays to check all their lines. You can detect smaller deletion or smaller gain using this. You can use, as I mentioned, so the ddPCR, in our case, we just check one gene, BCL2L1, but the company Stem Genomics in France is now providing a service where they look at the most common abnormalities using ddPCR, so it's extremely sensitive. It's extremely fast, and it's much cheaper than karyotype. So what we want is something that gives an answer quickly. And like I said early on, we had a lot of abnormal karyotype. It took 2 weeks for us to get the results. So you're waiting, and then you find out that these clones that you took months to create are garbage. Yeah. So being able to test quickly and at a very low cost is definitely key for us. So we are research, and we are obviously not focusing so much on cGMP or clinical grade IPS. Obviously, for clinical grade IPS, you need to think a lot more about all the different mutation that could arise during the reprogramming and doing the expansion. So we had one collaboration with the group at Dana-Farber where we generated some cGMP lines. And what we did for this line is a test called OncoPanel.
Yes.
And we looked at, I think it was 446 about oncogenes. And we are looking at any CNV or SNV in this 446. Oncogene. So instead of doing RNA-seq or full genome sequencing, we decided to focus on just oncogene.
Yeah.
We don't know if this is the best approach, but it's, again, a choice. There will be a lot of work that will be needed to make sure the cells are safe by testing, like I said earlier, the batch of cells. In this case, it's for beta cell differentiation. In animal models, but at least if we start with cells that have no mutation in oncogene, we'll feel a lot more comfortable using these cells for the next step.
Yeah, I think we're kind of in a situation where we have either the needle in a haystack situation or under the lamppost situation. And so obviously, you since time is of the essence, especially in terms of modelization, because the risks are much more limited. But I think both approaches are feeding one another. For example, right. ddPCR, which is an approach of under the lamppost, looking for something right. that you know can be wrong, has been fed from phishing without knowing what was happening. Typically, again, the 20q mutation. Right. But it's just that I think you cannot, like finding a single mutation in 3.5 billion base pairs within a population, because not everyone might carry the mutation, is a very complicated task. But we are fortunate enough that the technologies are now out there to look for the ones that are usual suspects. We can even find point mutations in the genome if we know where to look. So that's kind of already a more comfortable position than we used to be. And that's a process. And that's where the research is like really super important to be able to move forward in the coming years.
Right, because what are the mutations that are relevant
is
a big question.
Yes.
And if you start with IPS line especially, and if you start with samples from patients that are already in their 50s, 60s, obviously they accumulated a lot of mutation during their life. But this mutation most likely have no real effect on the cells because the patients don't have the tumor. So if you do full genome sequencing, which was the approach the Japanese chose in the first place, but it was because it was the first clinical trial using IPS derivatives, so they had to be extremely careful. But if you do full genome sequencing, you find some mutation, are you going to charge this IPS line, or are you going to try to find out what this mutation does, and how do you find out? So it's one thing to be very thorough in your search for mutation, but the main question is, what does it mean that you, for the cells to have this mutation there?
So this is also linked with the fact that we can't predict the impact of a given mutation. I mean, there are some, again, usual suspects. If anything is affecting a big protein like TP53, then you're like, okay. but obviously, whenever a cell divides in the body, there is background accumulation of mutation. That's just the way things work. And telling a bad mutation from a non-malign, like a totally benign mutation is a very hard work. So that's true that what we clearly have to do in terms of therapy is looking, we must be looking under the lamppost, because otherwise we won't move forward and it's not better for patients. But we have to be, I think there could be a two-tier strategy where you, since the tools are now available, you do a full genome sequencing because it's not that costly, at least if you are in an allogeneic strategy, and you look for the usual suspects. And if ever something happens, then you can back correlate and lower the risk for the next generation.
Right. And so if you start with IPS, I think, I don't know the strategy for the Japanese bank. I don't know the age of the donors. And I believe they had some IPS line derived from fibroblast and blood. It was shown that IPS derived from fibroblast have accumulated UV,
induced mutations,
Mutation based on, I mean, that are due to UV exposure.
Yeah.
Exposure is what I was looking for.
Yeah.
So if you use blood, you might be able to avoid this UV mutation. And I don't know the age of the donor they use, but cord blood, I think,
yes,
is the way to go. I don't know if this is what they do there, but having the possibility to start with cells that are young,
yes,
and cells that have not been exposed to any potential environmental stress, I think is key. So thinking about the best cell type to start when you make your IPS for cGMP for clinical applications is very important too.
Yeah, I totally agree about the blood, the cord blood source, because I think it's accumulating lots of interesting things. It's kind of fresh out of the biggest test you can ever run, which is a normal development. I mean, the baby is born, You can sort of check whether it's healthy or not. So you somehow now know that the genetic background is sound. Also, it's not been exposed to environmental stress, at least
right.
not very strong one, hopefully. And also, yeah, the cell is young, and I think it's really something important, because even though we've demonstrated now in the field that you can reprogram cells from any individual, however old, you still have the history of the patient, the epigenetic history of the patient, by the way, and when you start from a very young cell, then the stress of the reprogrammation is hopefully lower, because you start from something that is closer in terms of epigenetic to the target you are looking for. And so by accumulating a lower background mutation, an easier reprogrammation, and also a wide access, because there is a lot of cord blood banks out there, and the HLA matching, for example, is very easy to have as infos on this source, I really think that this is right now the most relevant source to think with.
Do you know if the Japanese bank is made out of cord blood? I don't think so. The first one for sure were fibroblasts derived, and I think they switched to blood, but I don't think it was cord blood.
I know that there is a lot of strategies working with cord blood. I don't know about Japan. I know that there is strategies in Germany. In France, for example, it's quite complex, because in France, the cord blood is an anonymized gift. So there are lots of issues about infos of the donors, and so it's not easy to do that. And in Germany, it's more easy, actually. And there's lots of different legal situations. But I feel scientifically and technically, I feel it's a good approach.
Yeah.
So I'm looking, because we've covered a lot of things. It's been an hour. Maybe we
can have a break. That's good.
Thanks a lot, because it feels like a nice conversation, and maybe we can make a very nice.
You know what's missing? It's a beer.
yeah. So
I like to have this conversation at the bar, drinking with friends. Yeah. This is what's missing here.
Yeah. We'll find a way to make that happen. Maybe with the COVID it's gonna be delayed a little, but maybe we can just remotely share a beer. Something that we can do.